Welcome back to module number 6 of our Jumpstart, Windows Azure Pack Infrastructure as a Services. I'm Simon Perryman, and I'm joined in this session by Anshuman, and we're really going to be focusing on extensibility with the Windows Azure Pack. Let's take a quick look at where we are in the day. So up to now, we've kind of established our key learnings. We've kind of built our Windows Azure Pack. We've designed everything, put the fabric together, and now we're really going to be focusing on what can we do with using our third parties. Now, you have to keep in mind that Windows Azure Pack is built by our internal Windows engineering teams. However, there are some solutions that Microsoft just doesn't quite complete. And so what we're really trying to do is leverage these third-party solutions to provide integration that we're not offering directly in this version. So what we wanted to do is we're going to take a look at some of our extensions using Cloud Cruiser, using Grid Pro, and you're going to see how we're going to integrate with a variety of different third-party solutions. But now let me turn it over to Anshuman, and why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself, please.
Thank you. My name is Anshuman. I am a program manager on the Service Manager team, which is part of the System Center suite of products. And I have been working on Service Manager for about 2 years now, roughly in the same client and data center management space. Welcome to this session. As Simon mentioned, is titled Extending WAP Using Third-Party Services, Third-Party Resource Providers like Grid Pro and Cloud Cruiser. So this session is roughly divided into three modules. We will have the first module, which is going to very briefly go into WAP extensibility in general, which is going to lay the groundwork for the next two following sessions, which is request management with Grid Pro and billing and chargeback with Cloud Cruiser.
Great, so let's walk through the goals of this session then.
Sure. So the objectives of this session is that I hope to provide you with some insight into how you can bring together your cloud services, as well as the ability to provide ITSM and chargeback capabilities into a complete offering, which you can then offer out to your customers who then consume your cloud services. You can think of it as almost like any service or any resource that you have on Windows Azure Pack. It needs to be managed, it needs to be accounted for, and it needs to be tracked in some way. So these are the capabilities which are surfaced with these third-party providers, which we'll be talking about today. Here's an interesting statistic. It's somewhat old, but it has been, I think it still holds true, is that for any sizable organization, about 30% of the organization's budget is actually spent on creating new, adding new things to their infrastructure, creating more new things in their environment, with about 70% still going towards maintaining and operating existing infrastructure. So in this session, we'll be touching upon both on the operations and operability and maintenance side of things, as well as support on the provisioning side. In this session, we will also be talking about enabling governance and control for your clouds using Windows Azure Pack, as well as enabling usage and spending tracking in your WAP environment towards the end. The big takeaways here in this session are, one is that in your WAP environment, ITSM is extremely important. IT service management is extremely important. It is very critical for your cloud. Not only does it enable you to provide the most operational, most efficient way to manage your clouds, but it also allows you to bring in processes which can then be, which can then allow for IT industry standard practices and automation to be put in. To kind of ease the manual day-to-day activities of your workforce, and it also touches upon the second key takeaway here is that the cloud financial management is an essential component to delivering scalable, profitable, and financially transparent cloud services. So those very roughly are the goals. So let's jump straight into WAP extensibility overview. In this case, I think this might have already been covered in the previous sessions, but the key thing here to note is that WAP, or Windows Azure Pack, is built with extensibility kept in mind from the ground up. So extensibility is not an afterthought. It is something which was thought about fairly deeply and very in a very controlled and deliberate way from the very beginning. What this means is that when you deploy WAAP into your environment, you are creating a ability to integrate that into your into the employment that you're deploying it into. This means for customers is that when they deploy WAAP, they have the ability to integrate it into their existing identity services provider. They have the ability to integrate it into their any custom self-service portals that they might have. They can enable automation using PowerShell and so many other services that we haven't thought of yet. So in that sense, extensibility is a core component of Windows Azure Pack. And I believe that at this point, let's talk about resource providers very briefly. So I believe at this point, we all know that resource providers in Windows Azure Pack are represented by or are the containers, or they are responsible for creating and managing the resources that you could then consume on Windows Azure Pack. A specific example of this might be, for example, the SQL Server resource provider, MySQL resource provider, Service Bus resource provider, VM resource provider. So there are certain resource providers that you get out of the box when you use Windows Azure Pack. But at the same time, we also give you the ability to define custom resource providers, which are essentially built on top of the same infrastructure and the same structure as your default resource providers. So in this case, when you have custom resource providers, you have to keep the following things in mind. They have to provide the following functionality. They have to have a custom extension for the UI, which for both the admin portal and the tenant portal. They have to have custom controllers which control the UI for both the portal, the admin experience as well as the tenant experience, and they have to have four endpoints which need to be constructed for any resource provider. These are namely the usage endpoint, the admin endpoint, the notification endpoint, and the tenant endpoint. Now, I'm not going to go into a lot of detail on what these endpoints are, but there is a lot of information out there which you can read on extensibility and creating your own custom resource providers to give you that information to help you understand what these endpoints are and how do you bring them in.
Now, just to be clear, if somebody wants to write their own custom resource provider, do they actually need to go ahead and write code, right? I'm assuming, can they use C#, something like that?
They can. It is a the way custom resource providers are written is that you have these endpoints that you have to then author,
okay.
and you can use in this case, the for example, the custom extensions would be written using JavaScript. The controller has to be written using a different, of course, a different platform. But yes, you can use you can define these, and you can have these custom resource providers created fairly easily once you look at these blogs online.
Okay, great, thanks. Okay. And we'll post the links to those
absolutely.
So everybody can.
They
have
are included
them.
Towards the end of the presentation. Right. So with that, that was a really rough, very high-level overview of extensibility in Windows Azure Pack. What you have next is we're going to talk about request management with GridPro. Before we talk about that, let's have a quick look at some of the challenges that currently face or impact people who are using Windows Azure Pack. One of the key components which I believe is missing is the lack of governance, which means that if you have resources, if you're consuming a resource on Windows Azure Pack, there is very little in ways of ensuring governance on it or in tracking it and seeing how what is happening in the cloud and who is doing what and what is the end result of and where things are at any point in time. So this impacts people who are not only consuming the resources in Windows Azure Pack, but also people who want to support it, and they are the ones who are managing change. So they want to have insight into what is going on, right? The second thing is that the second challenge that is fairly obvious at this point is that you need to have a quicker way of adding new services or changing existing running services in Windows Azure. The request management solution The extension that has been built by GridPro is, GridPro being one of the partners who partnered very closely with Microsoft, and they have been working on creating this resource extension for Windows Azure Pack. It enables bringing together a service manager and WAP in a really unique way. And in doing so, it addresses the following challenges. It comes up with a solution which looks as follows. It brings approval and tracking to the cloud using Service Manager. Now, Service Manager is a really awesome tool when it comes to approval and tracking, and it allows you to create processes and industry best practices to control change, support incidents, and whatnot. So it allows you to bring that functionality over into Windows Azure Pack. The second thing which this solution provides is that it allows adding of features which are not available out of the box with Service Manager, with Windows Azure Pack in a very fast and easy and convenient way. So what this means is that you can use this resource extension along with Service Manager to add services to Windows Azure Pack in a standardized way, ensuring governance while also delivering the service in hours and days versus weeks or months, right? So there's a huge, huge win here that can be realized. Finally, it uses, it brings together the Service Manager capabilities as well as Windows Azure Pack capabilities into one console, into one consistent experience. So anytime your tenants have to reach out to support, anytime they have to do self-service fulfillment or request self-services, they do so from within the context from the Windows Azure Pack portal. Right, so really briefly, let's have a quick look at what are the four core components that you get with Windows Azure Pack. You get self-service, you get a self-service experience, clearly. You get consistent management, which means you have the tenant and the admins doing things the same way, essentially. You have common identity, so which means that people can log, there is a single way to log in and you don't have to log in more than once. You don't have to authenticate yourself more than once, rather. And you have usage and metering platform, which basically gives you the capabilities to realize chargeback, to do capacity planning, and to do a bunch of other things once you have this information available to you. So Windows Azure Pack provides that platform, that holistic platform for you. And now let's look at what Service Manager gives you. Service Manager gives you self-service capabilities. It allows, it gives you these self-service capabilities in the context of a service catalog. So for those of you who've used Service Manager in the past or haven't, a service catalog is basically a collection of services which can then be consumed by your tenants, and you can choose to, it can hold service requests, it can hold incidents that can be reported by your tenants. So it brings together these capabilities in the context of a service catalog, which is provided out of the box with Service Manager in the self-service portal. Now, when you think about it, conceptually, the service catalog and the way you consume services in the service catalog is not really very different from how you would consume services in the context of Windows Azure Pack. Because on one hand, you have people who are requesting things like I need a new phone, for example. I need a new account that needs to be provisioned using the service catalog. On the other side, on the WAP side, you have people requesting services like, hey, I need a new VM, I need a new database, I need a new website, for example. So conceptually, they're not very different. They kind of make sense when you think about them and you want to bring them together. Service Manager also allows you to do a really good job of, it's an excellent tool. It's an excellent tool when you want to do standardization and automation of IT processes. It makes it ridiculously easy to bring in industry standard best practices around IT infrastructure management. Into your environment, into your IT management capabilities. And it also makes it really easy for you to apply governance and control and compliance. So when you think about it, when you look at the challenges which we just mentioned, which are existent right now in Windows Azure Pack around governance, around not being able to add new services, Service Manager does fill in that gap to some extent. And what this resource provider, which has been written by GridPro, does is that it allows for an integration between these two components to realize the coming together and value that you get out of this integration. So again, really quickly, what is of interest to us here today is the capabilities that on one side you have of Windows Azure Pack and the capabilities that on the other side that you have of Service Manager and the integration that can be realized between them using the resource provider or using the request management solution from Grid Pro. So that any contact, again, that your tenants have with IT or with any kind of self-service happens and is consumed through the Windows Azure Pack experience. Okay. Really quickly, just some solutions and benefits of what it is that you get with when you realize this integration. This integration allows you to have service providers to offer service catalog from Service Manager, which would traditionally be shown in the context of a service catalog, which you get with the out of the box Service Manager self-service portal, and it allows you to show that in the context of Windows Azure Pack. We already talked about this. In this case, the service provider is. It can be anyone who's providing IT services. It could, for example, be an enterprise which is providing services to their own internal business units. It could be a hoster who is providing services to their tenants. It doesn't really matter. That's the point, right? Service provider can be at anyone at this point.
Maybe we could spend a minute kind of talking about some of the different types of scenarios. You know, oftentimes when we think about self-service, people think it's just limited to infrastructure, right? I want to go deploy a VM. I want to go scale it up. But I think one of the advantages or the strength of it is that it really is an open catalog. You could essentially tie it together with any backend system. So for example, you might have people that are onboarding to your company. Once someone new joins the company, usually IT gets an email. They take out the first name, the last name, office location. That's information they get from HR. They then manually inject it. If we published that type of information as a form to our HR team and human resources entered those field in a self-service catalog, could we use that, tie that together on the back end, and go and perform a certain task?
Absolutely. Actually, that is one of the scenarios that I'm going to get into.
Okay, I jumped ahead of you a bit.
Yeah, you did, actually. The thing is that you can take almost any self-service experience that you can provide right now with Service Manager. It doesn't have to be infrastructure related. It doesn't have to be VMs or IaaS related in any way. It could just be something as simple as provisioning a new user or deprovisioning a user for that matter. And you can take that and you can make that service available within the context of Windows Azure Pack.
So a question for you. Do you have any best practices for our audience out there around what type of offerings or what type of services does their IT department offer that would be good candidates for self-service?
Absolutely. Anything, the way I would answer this question is anything that can be turned into a self-service experience, any kind of request fulfillment that can be automated, can benefit from the application of standard IT processes is a good candidate for this kind of transition where you bring that bring that out from your service catalog into a single consistent Windows Azure Pack experience in the web portal. So as a tenant, I could just log in. I can see all the different requests that are available to me, service requests that are available to me. I can generate incidents, and I can just fill in the necessary information within the context of Windows Azure Pack, and that gets piped straight through Service Manager. And Service Manager can then take care of implementing the IT processes and the best practices that have.
So back on Service Manager, that's where it will create the tickets. That's where people can go and then manage that, like regular.
So as a tenant. The idea here is that as a tenant, you work within the context of Windows Azure Pack. Mm-hmm. But as an analyst, you would still want to work within the context of the Service Manager console, the thick console, the on-prem console that we provide. Because that is where you would be managing your IT requests, break fix requests, I want requests, or any kind of request or incidents that might come through. As an analyst, that is where you live and breathe 24/7.
Now, you also mentioned when you were discussing some of those good candidates that things would be tied together with automation. What happens if I want to do a manual approval step? Is that possible?
Oh, absolutely, yeah. So again, that is something that I'm going to get into the scenario, but yes, that is absolutely possible. So a key point of governance and being able to control your IT organization's spending, being able to control sprawl, is to put in these human breakpoints, if you will, manual breakpoints into an IT process. And that can be done within the context of Windows Azure Pack and of course, using Service Manager to run the backend, and then all of this dynamically gets rendered in Windows Azure Pack. We're going to go into that into a fair bit of detail in one of the demos, and I'll be walking through it, and you'll get to see that in action.
Okay, I'll slow down. I'm getting ahead of us.
Okay, thank you. All right. So with this, solutions and benefits, again, just really quickly. Service Manager benefits with integration on WAP because Windows Azure Pack allows for a multi-tenant experience. For those of you who've used Service Manager, you will know that Service Manager does not, by default or out of the box, support multi-tenancy. So this is a big win, actually. There's a big feature addition that has been realized by bringing these two awesome components together. And then it also makes it really easy, because Service Manager and the resource extensions and the request management provider, which has been authored by GridPro, builds on top of the identity services which are provided by Windows Azure Pack. It makes it really easy for users to kind of log in and consume those services. So this is a common problem with service providers, especially because they have to manage multiple domains which do not have trust relationships established within them. So for them, it becomes really easy to have this kind of identity management, which is provided by Windows Azure Pack, either using extensibility and providing, and a customer using their own identity solution, or leveraging something leveraging a Microsoft identity solution. And of course, it has one portal, so it supports the CloudOS story, and it brings the two experiences together. Okay, so there are, just really quickly, there are about three different scenarios that can be realized when you bring these two solutions together. The first one, of course, is that if you have multiple tenants, as you can see on the screen now, if you have multiple tenants, and these are really small tenants. This is a single resource provider scenario where you have an organization's IT service management being handled by a single service manager instance. You could think of this as an enterprise which has different business units. And all these business units, they don't necessarily have a need for isolation. They are comfortable having all their tickets and information live in the single instance of Service Manager, and you have a single instance of Windows Azure Pack. So this is one scenario which is covered in that sense. The second scenario that we have here is of each tenant bringing in their own solution of Service Manager, or bringing in their own instance of Service Manager. So this is typically for service providers who have or hosters who have multiple tenants and they want isolation. And so in this case, each tenant, all the requests created by each tenant would live in a single in their own instance space of Service Manager, and they wouldn't necessarily overlap, and gives them physical isolation as well. The third scenario, which is almost like a hybrid scenario, is when you have tenants which are smaller and can consume and can have their incidents and tickets live on a single instance of Service Manager, versus larger tenants which have a need for either performance, or they have some security concerns and they want their own instance of Service Manager. They can have multiple resource providers in this case. So one instance of Service Manager being shared by multiple tenancy, and the other one isolated for use by a different tenant. I'm going to go into a little bit of detail on how you can bring together two different or multiple Service Manager instances to live under a single instance of Windows Azure Pack, and we're going to go into that next. So let's have a quick demo here. So in the first demo, we will talk about, as I mentioned earlier, and something that Simon also brought up, is enabling new services faster. This is going to be roughly about a 10-minute demo, and then followed by a support request for help, which is about a 15 to 20-minute demo. So let's jump straight into that and do the demo.
Well, while you switch over, I would like to ask everyone to complete the first poll question we have in this module. And we're asking, how likely is your organization to use a customizable IaaS solution for self-service offerings? So basically, are you thinking of taking advantage of providing self-service through the Windows Azure Pack? So if you could please minimize from the full screen view, answer our question. This gives us some great feedback about what level of investment we should be making in the stack of technologies. You ready for the demo?
I am, yes.
Let's do it.
Let's go. All right. So for those of you who've seen, I'm assuming that at this point, sitting through the different sessions, people have managed to familiarize themselves with the Windows Azure Pack look and feel. But what you will notice here that on the left ribbon, we have this link here called Request Management, which is an artifact of the resource, of the Request Management extension that was authored by GridPro, right? So let's start with this. Let's just quickly run through what this landing page here for request management means and what the different links that need to be run through. So you get the request management extension by default when you have when you download Windows Azure Pack through the web platform installer. When you do this and you open up your Windows Azure Pack portal, you will see this link on the left, and you will see a bunch of links here. Once you click on it, you'll see a bunch of links here that you need to run through to complete, to have all the pieces come together. So the first thing that you need to do is that you need to download this web service, the simple web service, which you can download by clicking on this link. In this case, of course, I've all these services downloaded and working as expected, but this is a really simple experience. So you download and install the Request Management API, which basically is a translation service between Service Manager and Windows Azure Pack. The second thing that you do is, once you have this service installed, is that you register your Service Manager connection. Now, in this case, I have a Service Manager connection which is already registered. So if I go into Request Management and click on Connect To, you will see that I have the option of adding an instance name for Service Manager, endpoint, username, and password. Once I have this information filled in, what I've managed to do is that I have created a connection between my Service Manager instance and Windows Azure Pack. So these two are absolutely essential steps. The third step here is to upgrade to the premium features of request management. The free offering that you get, or the offering of request management that you get with the web platform installer, is a freemium offering, so it does have certain limitations, and if you want to have the full experience, then you have to upgrade to the premium version of request management, which of course is not free. This is how you set up request management. This is a very easy experience.
And sure. just for one clarifying question here, if somebody wants to get this, can they get all the binaries through the web PI, the web platform installer, or do they need to go to some separate site to download, configure everything?
Okay, so they can get all the binaries for the UI here that you see. When you install Windows Azure Pack through the web platform installer, but you still have to go and manually fetch the web service that has been authored by GridPro from their website, and you need to download it and install it, and basically that's it. And
great.
Once that is done, then you tie the pieces together, and you have a working Service Manager integration with Windows Azure Pack.
Thanks. And if you go to GridPro's website, they do include pretty rich documentation for all of those steps to get up and running as well.
Yep. Okay, so in this case, the scenario that we're talking about is enabling the realization of new services in a fast and easy way. And one of the ways to do that is actually through one of the components that we are going to be touching fairly heavily at this point is automation. So in this case, what we're using is we're using service management automation and a runbook which has been authored within Service Manager, SMA, SMA. So if I click on this runbook, it will bring up the number of executions, et cetera, of this runbook. And if I switch to authoring mode, you will see that this is the PowerShell script, which basically does something really simple. It goes in and provisions a new user in Active Directory. So the scenario that we'll get to the scenario in a bit, but there are a few main components that are at play here. There is the automation component, because again, you want to automate some of these activities to get benefit from them and to reduce your manual workload. You want to be able to call this automation from within Service Manager and have some sort of an approval process in place before this automation is kicked off, and we're going to get into next. So I just wanted to show you this runbook that is going to get executed, and it's an important artifact for this scenario. So I think we can now switch over to Service Manager really quickly and talk about the different artifacts that need to be created in Service Manager for this scenario to succeed. Now, again, this is a demo and this is a learning experience. This is an educational experience. So I'm going to walk through the different artifacts that need to be created. Again, there's a lot of information on Service Manager and documentation existing on creating service templates, service request templates, and runbook activities and such online. So I'm not going to go into too much detail, but I'm going to walk through the basic steps that need to be performed.
And we'll go ahead and actually post the link to that training on the Microsoft Virtual Academy right now as well.
Absolutely. Right. So in this case, you can see that I have a new button here on the left, which says Smart Runbooks. What this does is we are using a SMA connector, which has, again, been authored by GridPro. It is it allows for Service Manager to integrate with service management automation, and it allows you to pull these runbooks, which have been authored by within SMA into Service Manager. So these are basically, this is just a listing of the runbooks that exist in SMA. The next thing that you do is you have to go into templates. Once you have these runbooks in place, once Service Manager is aware of these runbooks, it's really easy to go and create activities around these runbooks. An activity essentially is a way for you to kick off that runbook, either in the context of SMA, SMA, or in the context of Orchestrator. So in this case, I have created a template which should be called provision. All right. So you will see here that I have a runbook template which says RB:provision new consultant. Now, this is the activity which I have created, which kind of wraps around the runbook, and it tells the runbook what to do and how, what input parameters to expect. The next thing, once I'm happy with this activity here, I next go into the service request template, which I have open right here. And the service request template is has a tab here, which is called activities, which basically lists, it's a workflow. It's almost like a flowchart of the different activities that need to happen for this request to be realized, for this service request to be fulfilled. In this case, the service request being provisioning a new user on Active Directory. Right, so as you will notice here that the first activity here is a review activity, which means that before a user can be provisioned, it, the user needs to be approved. And then the second activity, of course, here is the activity we spoke about, which calls into SMA to complete the automation, which would then complete the service request fulfillment. So with that done, let me just switch out of this really quickly and go into, go back into Windows Azure back. Now, let's imagine for a second here that I am a HR. I'm going to log in as an, so contoso.com, and once I'm logged in, I'm in HR. I'm responsible for provisioning new consultants. This is a big organization. We have consultants come in fairly often. They work, and then they complete the tenure, and then they go back or to either to the parent organization or the switch projects. So it's a fairly common thing for new consultants to be provisioned in this organization. So what I'm going to do next is quickly go over to the request tab. And it says that I have not created any requests. That's not true. I was there are a few closed requests which have been hidden. So you have this checkbox here which allows you to hide closed requests. So what I'm going to do next is I'm going to go and create a new request. Again, all of this has been authored in Service Manager. There is actually, let me quickly switch back to Service Manager. There is one more thing that I wanted to show you is if I go into the service catalog. Now, as we talked about earlier, that there is the service catalog component which we're now showing up in Windows Azure, right? Windows Azure Pack. So the way that shows up is that you have to author a request offering. And let's just have a quick look at it. Provision consultant. So I have a request offering here, which is basically called provision consultant. What a request offering allows you to do, let me just quickly step into this. And what a request offering allows you to do is that it allows you to capture, it allows you to give the title, which would then show up in Windows Azure Pack. It would allow you to, it allows you to define the description of this service offering. It allows you to define the icon that you want to show up, and it also allows you to define all the different questions that you want asked from your users who who will then be consuming, or your tenants who will then be consuming the service request. So for example, in this case, we are asking questions like, what's the first name, last name, city, security clearance, et cetera. This request offering also allows you to do is that it allows you to define the prompt type, which could either be text or it could be a simple list, it could be numbers. It basically allows you to structure your data, and it tells Windows Azure Pack and your tenants on what kind of input they are expected to provide. So once you have this information filled out, you go back in and map this information, like first name, which has been input, which has been inputted by the user, and you configure it, and then you map it into different properties of of the tickets of the object that you've created in Service Manager. So in this case, for example, the description, the provision new consultant service request has a field called description, which is going to map to the business description, which is going to be provided by the person filling out this form in Windows Azure Pack. Okay, so with this done, let's switch back to Windows Azure Pack really quickly and create a new request, create a provision consultant request. So again, all the information that I'm entering here is controlled by Service Manager. So let's just create a new user called Jane Doe. Select city to be Seattle. Security clearance to be, say, top secret. You'll notice that all our security clearances start with confidential. We don't have anything below that. And we have account expiration date set to, say, the end of September this year. You'll also notice that all the information that you're filling out will start showing up on the right here as you fill out the service request. So it allows you to, so for binary questions, for Boolean answers, like does Jane need email? Yes. Does she need IAM? Does she need Windows access to Windows Azure Pack? All of this information is marked as yes, or is shown up as these really cool, in this really cool UI, so you can just flip them to yes or no. You want to add the person who will be hosting this consultant. So I just add, say, for example, Anders Ravenholt here as the person who's hosting her. You add the project that Jane will be participating on. For example, in this case, that is hybrid clouds. So again, all of this information is coming, again, from Service Manager, and it is being shown. You get all these things in Service Manager by default, but it is just being shown in the Windows Azure Pack context right here. And I step through this. I say business justification, please provision new consultant. Not the best business justification, but it gets the point through. And I basically hit OK at this point. So what is happening now at this point is that in the context of Windows Azure Pack, I, as an HR, for example, have managed to create a new request. I haven't had to call up anyone from IT. I was able to do self-service. I did not have to go into the self-service portal or in the service catalog that has a different experience than Windows Azure Pack. So within the context of Windows Azure Pack, I can create this request, and then I can track its execution. So if I step into this request, service request that I've just provisioned, that I've just created, I'll be able to see all the information that I entered. I will also be able to see that this service request has two activities included within it. The first one is approving the approval of this request, and then the second one is this smart runbook that we just talked about. So if I go into Service Manager and if I switch to work items.
And I think one thing to know within the work items, if you guys are not that familiar with Service Manager, considering deploying it, keep in mind that it is built on top of ITIL, the IT infrastructure library. So if you've used any other ticketing systems, transitioning over to that isn't too bad. You kind of have that same workflow, you know, work items, request items, problem management, incident management, that same type of thing. So you'll see this in the next example, that consistency with ITIL.
Absolutely, yeah. So in this case, you can see the service request that I created is now showing up. As an analyst now, I can see that, yes, there is a new request here. I don't really have to do much with it because this is not an analyst specific operation. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to log in as Jane's manager, because as Jane's manager, I am the one who's our future manager. I am the one who has to approve this request. So let me quickly log back in as Jane's manager. I've already created a user here, John Smith. So okay. Oh. snafus. Right?
Now, while you do that, I'll answer another question that's come up as part of this example. It says, why do we have to use Service Manager when making requests? Would it be possible to just offer some type of interface and directly plug that into Orchestrator or SMA? That is true, you could do that, but really the big advantage of using Service Manager is that ticketing and that inventory. You know, anytime you get a service request, you get that formal ticket as part of your IT help desk management so that you can track that, you can do reporting on it. So it really is a best practice to still involve Service Manager as part of this end-to-end workflow, even if in some cases you may be able to kind of bypass that as well.
And it also gives you the governance and control capabilities which you get with Service
Great point
Manager.
Too,
so
yep.
that's something that you will that becomes somewhat more difficult to get, and it has industry best practices. So in this case, as let me just step back really quickly. I think we missed this a little bit. So I've logged in as John Smith, who's Jane's future manager, and I see that there are a bunch of activities which are pending on me at this point. So I'm going to hide the completed one so that I only see the one which is active at this point. So I click into this. I see that, okay, I have an approval request for provisioning a new consultant, but I don't have all the information. So what I can do is that I have a link here called Parent Work Item. I click on this, and it gives me all the information that I need to make an intelligent decision about this approving or not approving this request. So I can see that, okay, what's the name of the consultant, the security clearance, when does their account expire, and all this other information. So I'm going to cancel this. I'm going to say, yes, sure. I have been waiting for Jane to start working here, and I'm going to approve her request. So as soon as I do this, you'll see that the green bar at the top has gone to completed. There was only one approval needed as defined in Service Manager. So now that we have this approval, this request or this activity is completed at this point. So if I transition back into my HR mode and I refresh this, fairly soon what I will see is that the approval activity has gone through to completion. And what follows next is, there you go. So this activity is completed. What follows next is the provision new consultant automation activity, which I have, which is going to complete on its own, so I don't have to really interfere with it. So again, a new service has been provided here, which was not available out of the box with Windows Azure Pack, and it was really easy to do so by bringing together Service Manager and Windows Azure Pack using the request management extension that has been authored by GridPro. So while this is still happening, what I can do is that I can transition over to the domain controller and see that, the automation hasn't gone through yet at this point, but let's wait for it for a second. If not, what we can also do is we can track the execution of the smart runbook by transitioning over to the admin portal. And if I go into automation, I will see here that this has, there's a new consultant user smart runbook request, which has just been kicked off. It is still running. So as soon as this completes, what you will see is that we'll have a new user provision within Active Directory. There you go. So Jane Doe, we've taken the first two letters of her first and last name, and that user is now provisioned. So that completes the first part of this demo, which provides you with the information on how you can realize new services, enable new services within the context of Windows Azure Pack.
Great. So we have the results back from our first poll question in the module as we were looking at what percentage of you guys are considering actually using an ITSM ticketing system. Turns out 75% of you are likely or very likely to go and deploy this. So this is a really good indicator that this
Absolutely.
Is something very important. And so that was actually 25% were somewhat likely, 25% were very likely, 25% were definitely. And then that last quarter of the people, they were still kind of split. 10% said no way, 15% are still undecided. So it could even be as high as 90% of people
actually
want to go ahead and use some type of ticketed system, service request system. So great data on that. Thanks for filling out the poll.
Absolutely. So in the second demo, we're going to look at a similar... what you just saw, let me take a step back here. What you just saw was a day zero scenario where a new consultant has started working and we have automated or we've created a new service within the context of Windows Azure Pack, which allows them to be provisioned with a lot of ease. Now, the next demo is a day 30 scenario, for example, where Jane has started working in this organization and she is at this point working away, she's maybe testing some application, or maybe she's writing some code, and she needs a few VMs, for example, to complete a job. So switching back to the demo really quickly. Okay. So let's go back and log in as Jane Doe. I don't need to have this account logged in anymore, so I'm going to log out really quickly. And I'm going to log back in as Jane Doe, the user or the consultant that we have just provisioned.
Now, while you're logging back in, I would encourage everybody else to complete the second poll for this module. And we're asking, how likely is your organization to use customizable chargeback and showback reporting? And so this really ties back to billing systems. So let us know, how interesting is that to you to have this integration with WAP and various ticketing, various billing systems?
Okay. That's a good question. I'm looking forward to the answers on that. All right. So in this case, we have Jane Doe who's logged in into Windows Azure Pack. As you remember, when we were provisioning Jane Doe, we gave her access to Windows Azure Pack. And this is a day 30 scenario. It's a little bit orchestrated, but you get the idea. In this case, Jane has been working on a project called Hybrid Clouds. She has managed to provision three VMs. And she's going to do something which is very common when you use Windows Azure Pack. For example, I'm going to go and request a standalone virtual machine. I'm going to do a quick create. I'm going to call it, say, WAP jump start 04, right? And I'm going to call it, this needs to be a core VM, and I'm going to just quickly fill out some information about the password. Okay, yikes, sorry.
Ah. Passwords are the most stressful thing in a live demo. Now imagine if you were like a spy, there's a gun to your head. You would be not doing it all here. Okay, you got it this time.
Good, I got the password. Yeah. Fat fingers. Sorry. So in any case, as you can see, this new request has been created, but the request failed for some reason. We don't know why it failed. It just says failed to create a new virtual machine. Now, at this point, Jane, what do you think would be the normal response? I would normally call up someone.
I have no idea. I'm stuck, right? Yeah. I need help.
I'm going to call up someone, or I'm going to email someone and say, hey, what do I do next? What we allow you to do, what this request management solution allows you to do is that it allows you to create a new request, not a, let's just go into the operational support resources service offerings. And I'm going to create a generic incident request. This is an incident which has happened. I have not been able to provision a new VM. Cannot create VM. And I'm just going to paste this here, same thing. I'm going to select the category of the issue as virtual machine clouds problems. Again, all of this information, including this dropdown, the values that you see in this dropdown is coming directly from Service Manager. And you can define and change this in Service Manager really easily, right? I'm going to say 4 to 5, 5 to 5, 5 to 5, 5 to 5 as my number. So I create this request, and my request has been created at this point. What I can do is if I go into requests here, and I will see that I have a new incident request that is IR735, which is saying, I cannot create a VM. This is my subscription. Now, the subscription information is really important because Windows Azure Pack allows the same user to be on multiple subscriptions. So it becomes really easy for the analyst to know where Jane is coming from. And the status of this is active. So if I transition back really quickly into Service Manager, and I see that there is an incident which is open here. Let's sort it by ID. Right, there you are. Right. So you say, I just created this and it's already here. IR765 cannot create a VM. Now, I as an analyst will be like, okay, so what could possibly be going wrong here? So my first instinct is to go back into the admin portal and say, look at Jane's account. I'm going to go and look at Jane's account and the subscription that she has. I'm going to look at what is going on with a subscription? Why is she not able to provision a new VM? And there you go. I see that what's happening here is that she's run out of capacity. The plan that she subscribed to gave her three VMs, but she's trying to provision a fourth VM and it's not going to happen. So it's really easy for me to just go back here as an analyst. Now, as an analyst, this is my, in a typical real world scenario, you would have some sort of an email notification that goes out to different analysts when a ticket is created, like an incident is created, and saying that, hey, a new incident has been created, which has an SLA, for example, or a service level agreement of 30 minutes, and you have to respond to it within 30 minutes, otherwise it goes into a breach state. But I have luckily been able to, I know that I have to respond within 30 minutes, I was able to respond to it within 10 minutes. And I say here that you've run out of quota, Please request new VM capacity. Capacity using the self, using add more new resources request offering. Okay, and I add this. So as soon as I add this, what will happen is that if I go back into Jane's mode, which is right here, and I look at this incident which has just been created, and I go into tracking, I will see that there is a comment from the analyst. In this case, the analyst was Srikanth, which says, "Hey, you've run out of quota. Please request new VM capacity using this add new services request offering." And I can say, "I recommend here." Okay, thanks. I will. Okay, and I complete this. And you can see here that the conversation is really, really laid out in this really neat way so that you can see what is going on. And I go back, navigate into, so this was a support scenario, by the way, where I ran into a problem and I did not have to reach out to my IT help desk via phone call or email, and I was able to kind of reach out to them using within the context of Windows Azure Pack, and I was able to get a response back from them. And I have direction now on what I need to do to create a new VM, so or to request more capacity. So I go back into the request menu, I say create a new request, and I say cloud resources, and I click on request additional cloud resources. This is what the analyst recommended that I do. So I'm going to click into this. I'm going to choose provider reason, need for dev environment. I'm going to say, okay, I want 5 additional VMs, and I'm going to indicate the urgency as, say, for example, medium. This is not a super urgent request. I click on next, and I hit OK. So what's going to happen next here is that there is, like in the scenario that we went through previously, there was a approval request that had to be approved. So in this case, it's just 5 VMs. So the organization might decide that, hey, we don't need to manually police this request. It's just 5 VMs. You don't really care about it. If, for example, someone was requesting 100 VMs, then you would want to have some sort of a control mechanism put in place and require approval. So this capacity, this request is going to get approved. And what is going to happen next is that if I go back into my, if I go back into my requests, I will see here that I have a request which is active, which is, it's a new request, create a request for additional cloud resources. If I click into it, like before, I can see that it has all the information that I need, and it requires an approval of my immediate manager, as well as an automation which will get kicked off once the approval is granted to add, to put an add-on on the subscription for Jane, right? Now, here's the interesting part. In this case, this automation, which is being used for adding a new add-on on the subscription, is driven not by SMA, but by Orchestrator. So here's the runbook that is going to get executed. And it is going to initialize data. It is going to capture information like add-on name, which in this case was add 5 VMs, and internal ID, which is an internal ID which we're using for the request. So once we have that information, it is going to run through this flow, and it is going to execute a PowerShell script, which is going back, which is reaching back into Windows Azure Pack, and it will provision, it will add a new add the extra capacity of 5 VMs on Jane's plan, which you will then have the capacity to execute. So we're not going to wait for this to complete because we are time bound at this point. So that completes the first two parts of the demo, which is enabling new service. We saw how new services can be enabled. And then we also talked a little bit about, and we stepped through the process that needs to be followed for supporting requests for support requests for help. And all within the context of Windows Azure Pack without having to step out of it. Great. So I'm going to step into the next. So this was the screen which we had to stop on, but doesn't matter. It's all good. All right. So next, I'm going to step into billing and chargeback with Cloud Cruiser, which is the second part, which is the last module of this presentation. And this is going to be fairly quick. So you might be wondering, what is Cloud Cruiser? You may have heard this name before, but what is Cloud Cruiser? What does Cloud Cruiser do in the context of Windows Azure Pack, right? So Cloud Cruiser is another close partner of Microsoft, and they have been working in close collaboration with the Windows Azure Pack team to build what they call is the express version of Cloud Cruiser. Okay, so what is Cloud Cruiser? It is a solution which allows you to gives you a really easy way to view your IT usage and spending. In this case, in the context of WAP, it gives you a way to view your IT usage and spending in the context of Windows Azure Pack. The full-fledged Cloud Cruiser solution gives a lot more capabilities, like providing capacity management and some sort of capacity planning capabilities, as alerts, notifications, etc. So we know that not all of that translates into the Windows Azure Pack because, again, this is an express version, and you get it free when you install Windows Azure Pack using the Web PI installer. It provides billing and chargeback capabilities. It is automatically provided with your Windows Azure Pack download when you download it with the Windows Azure Pack with your Web PI installer. And it is, of course, the free version, the express version of Cloud Cruiser. So what do you get with Cloud Cruiser is that it collects data. Again, as I said earlier, it is a billing and chargeback provider, and it enables billing, and it builds on top of the billing platform and that Windows Azure Pack provides. So it collects information on usage of your virtual websites, virtual machines, databases, WAP managed objects, even the GridPro request management. For example, in this case, using Cloud Cruiser, you can actually track how many requests have been created by, say, within a certain plan, by a certain tenant. How much time did they take to get resolved? You can use plans to kind of shape the quota that is available to different to your tenants, and be able to manage all of that within the context of Windows within the context of Windows Azure Pack using Cloud Cruiser. So it takes all this information, which is collected from the usage databases of Windows Azure Pack, and it transforms, enriches, and automates some of that information using their own binaries, which you get as a separate download. I'm going to talk about that in a second. And it allows you, once you have this information, it has stepped through these three steps. It allows you to do some decision support capabilities like chargeback and billing, service analysis, customer analysis, demand forecasting. You can do some sort of demand forecasting, seeing how much your different tenants are using different plans, for example, and so on and so forth. The Cloud Cruiser Express installation overview is very simple. The UI side, just like it was the way with the request management extension, is that it downloads the UI extensions automatically when you download Windows Azure Pack. So you get that by default. You have to actually unselect it if you do not want it. But once you have that, you still need to go and download. You need to provision a VM, and you need to create a SQL Server database for the solution to work as expected. So you have a VM that will host here the Cloud Cruiser bits. And you have a SQL Server, which is going to store all the information that is processed, as I mentioned earlier, which is transformed, enriched, and then automated. It gets stored in the SQL Server, and then you can run some sort of reporting on this information. As I mentioned earlier, the Cloud Cruiser solution allows you to do billing and measure usage and capacity and usage on virtual machine, on websites, SQL Server databases, MySQL databases, etc. There is one thing, though, that you need to keep in mind here, that to manage or to measure or to have usage information on your virtual machines show up, there has to be some sort of, there is some configuration that is required in these different components that you see highlighted here. You need to enable Virtual Machine Manager, you need to enable Operations Manager, SPF, as well as the usage service to kind of have this information flow through, which can then be consumed by Cloud Cruiser. So there is some manual wiring up required here. The next slide here provides, again, I wouldn't call it trivial, the way this is, this needs to be wired up. So there is some work that needs to be done to wire up these different components. And there's a lot of really good, these three posts here especially are really useful if you want to learn more about it.
And I'll go post these into the chat window as well now, so okay. People have the direct links.
Great. Yeah. No. This was authored by Anders Ravenholt, one of the members of our PACE team, and these are absolutely wonderful. They give you a step by step guidance on how you can bring virtual machine usage information into Cloud Cruiser Express for Windows Azure Pack. Right, so let's just do a quick demo. This is going to be a really small demo on Cloud Cruiser.
Now, while you switch over, I'll share the results that we have so far. So about half of you have voted here, and we've kind of seen similar numbers. It looks like about 70% are definitely going to be using some type of billing and chargeback model. About 15% are unknown, and about 15% are unlikely to do that. So we're still seeing 70% of people have an interest in providing some type of capability through WAP about this.
Yeah.
Great indication that our partners are kind of trending in the right direction as far as what they're designing.
Right. We actually, as Microsoft, we ship this solution called Service Reporting, which provides you with some rudimentary chargeback and usage capabilities and information. You can have third-party billing providers integrate really easily into Windows Azure Pack, into the usage pipeline of Windows Azure Pack, and you have Cloud Cruiser, who've already created this extension, which you can put in to get more information about, to make it really easy to get at least light information about your usage trends, etc. So as you will see here, if once you have this extension installed, at the bottom you see this link here called User Costs. Once I click on it, I see a list of all the tenants that I have. As an admin, I'm logged in as an admin at this point. This is an admin view. I'll see all the different tenants that I have in my setup, right? And what I can do is that I can really easily look at what is the usage? What are the usage patterns for each of these tenants, as well as the total usage patterns as well? So if I step into reports really quickly, I can choose the tenant that I want to know more about. For example, I'm going to go to admin@fabricroom.com, and previous month is fine. And when I hit OK, what's going to happen is that if you remember, we talked about this database that is going to store usage information.
Where is that database?
Oh, you need to provision it on a different machine.
Okay, is it a SQL Server database?
Yes.
Okay.
Right, so you have a SQL Server database which you need to provision to realize this, and you also need to have a VM which will host the bits and the logic that Cloud Cruiser provides. So what you get by default with the Windows Azure Pack installer, WebAPI installer, is the UI components, but you still need to have these two different components light up.
Okay, great.
And again, this is all free at this point, but there is a more a comprehensive offering from Cloud Cruiser, which of course is a non-free version. The Cloud Cruiser Express version is free. So if I click on OK here, what it is doing is that it is generating an HTML-based report on the usage information that I have on this tenant specifically over the last for the previous month. So I can see information about how many about the VM resources which have been consumed. I can see information about the network resources which have been consumed, as well as SQL Server database information which has been consumed the last month. What you see here are units and rates. Now these rates and units, the rates specifically, cannot be controlled within the context of WAP. You need to step out of WAP so there are two portals that you need to work with here, and I'm not going to go into the second portal, but you get it, and you have it installed in the second VM where you install the Cloud Cruiser bits. So once you log into that, it gives you the ability to define these rates and control how you want your costs measured. Within the context of WAP, you get this really light view, which allows you to see and consume and observe how your tenants are consuming different aspects of your infrastructure. But it doesn't really allow you to define. For that, you need to step out and go into a different portal. You have the ability to either download this information as a PDF or a CSV. Again, this is a really light implementation. The admin functionality has to get that, you have to step out of Windows Azure Pack, and you have to step into the console that is provided by Cloud Cruiser on a different machine.
So is that where you would go and configure the price per hour of storage? Is this network, compute? Okay.
Yes. That is where this information...
And that's, of course, fully customizable as well, right?
That is completely customizable, yes. But we are not going to go into that at this point, because this is the intent here is to show the extension and the abilities that you get out of this extension here, right here. So... yeah, with that completed, let me just step out of the demo.
Great. Well, I think we're about to wrap up this module. I do want to point people to the System Center Alliance website, and I'm going to post the link in a minute. And this is essentially our single location where all of our System Center partners are going and providing their Windows Azure Pack extensions. So if you visit that site, select the hybrid cloud, you'll see the list of Grid Pro and Continuum, a whole variety of those different solutions. So check out that link. And what are the final closing words we have?
Just a revision, just a switch back to the objectives that we outlined earlier, that the key takeaways from this presentation or from this session are that, one, that ITSM is absolutely critical in your cloud environment if to control sprawl, to have some sort of processes which allow you to manage and control your IT spending, as well as put certain IT best practices into place. And that can really easily be achieved by integrating service manager using the request management solution from GridPro. And finally, the cloud, that it is absolutely equally important to have reliable, scalable, and profitable, to run a cloud which is profitable, scalable, reliable, and financially transparent, you need to have some sort of a chargeback or billing mechanism in place. You can either use something like Cloud Cruiser for it, hop onto their premium offering or use their freemium offering, or you can have any kind of third-party billing integrator or billing provider that you want to integrate with.
Excellent. Yeah. Well, thanks so much for that summary. You know, what we hope to have you get out of that as well is not just see that we are enhancing the partner ecosystem, but also offering some best practices. And really, when we designed Windows Azure Pack, we did think about what are best practices for, you know, self-service, automation, resource pooling, kind of these private cloud key tenets as well. And so you'll see we've now started to expose them up and working with our partners to go provide those end-to-end solutions. Well, with that, I want to thank you for joining me.
Thanks.
Great demos. Yeah. And we'll take a break. We'll be back in 10 minutes. And then we'll be covering our final module of the day, taking a look at some of the different tenant experiences, such as database as a service, platform as a service, and then some other kind of bits and pieces and Q&A for Windows Azure Pack. We'll be right back. Thank you.